glass and you wonder if the pain you feel is ever gonna pass. And when the darkness surrounds you, it might seem to have no end. Keep holding on, it won't be long, and you'll see the sun.
Turn your Bibles. The past 3 or 4 weeks, I've really been studying back and forth through this, and I appreciate how the Lord has not only been patient to be able to teach me, but I've been able to be able to take my time and actually allow the Word of God to try to come to life. How many of you know that sometimes we get too fast when we study the Bible? Amen. And I've learned that God is able and God can. We just have to slow down. And not only listen to the Word of God, but the truth be told, we need to heed to the Word of God. And if we'll heed to the Word of God, then we'll experience the power that can come with the Word of God. Amen? And I do. I praise the Lord for it. I'm going to be working in just a reading just a few verses tonight. And really, I want to start, if I may, I want to start reading probably down in verse number 16. And we're going to read through a few verses. Before I do, I want to remind you of something over the past probably, I don't know, 2 months that I took some liberty on Sunday or Wednesday nights, and we kind of talked about some things. We talked about getting things in order. We've talked about restructuring some things, if you will, repositioning some things. We went through in the Bible where the Bible says, the revelations, he says, nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee. Why? Because thou have left thy first love. And we begin to realize that a lot of times that we struggle in our walk with the Lord. We struggle in our life because what we do is we realize that when we first fell in love with Jesus Christ, it then changes. And when we change, things happen, and then we fall out of love, and we still love the Lord, but he's not our first love. And then we wonder why we suffer. And, you know, it's very symbolic of a marriage, if you will. So many times we want our families, our wives or our husbands or even our children to really be able to give us everything of them, but yet we don't love them like we used to. Work comes in play, and social events come in play, and activity comes in play, and TV comes in play, and we wonder why our marriage is not what it used to be. Well, the truth be told, it's because we learn to tolerate each other. We learn to exist. We don't function that way. And the same thing happens with the Lord, because the Bible said, never left thy somewhat against thee. Why? Because thou hast left thy first love. So the key word is this: it ain't God who left, it's us. Then we went into Matthew chapter number 6, I believe it is, verse number 33, where the Bible has said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. And we understood that a lot of times that we're seeking things of God, but the first thing that we have to seek out is the power and the authority of God. To be able to understand God's kingdom here on earth, you might not believe this or not, but I truly believe that you can live a little heaven on earth. Amen. There is a such thing as an abundant life. I'm not saying that this is heaven. Somebody say amen. Somebody say thank God. Amen. It's not heaven. I understand that. But he said, seek ye first the kingdom of God. In other words, seek ye first the rule and the authority of heaven. And when you seek that first, everything else will fall in line. You got to seek God first. There's one thing that many of us will skip over. We will do God things, and we'll do godly things, and we'll do religious things. And a lot of Christians and young Christians get caught up in that, and I did. I'll be honest, I really did. For a long time, I was doing the spiritual stuff. And you have to let me give you this introduction, because
A lot of times when I start telling you what the message is on my heart, some of us that understand what I'm going to be talking about, it kind of gets us excited because we've experienced, but there's a lot of people it gets to be boring. Because the one thing that we really don't know a lot about is really when the Bible, when it's all you have, it becomes to be so real because the Holy Ghost will speak through it. Because sometimes you can't hear God in a sermon. And you can't hear God in a song. And truth be told, and this might just be me, and it's fine, I'm thankful that you're better than I am. There's been times that I have prayed that I felt like, as the song says, I've prayed and literally I couldn't get through the very roof that was above my head because I felt so alone and so maybe even separated, distant. Not necessarily because of sin, but sometimes because of tragedy. Sometimes the cloud seems to be so dark and the night seems to be so long that you forget to think that God can speak. But when the Word of God is something that we sit down and we ponder, probably the most clearest moments that I've ever heard God speak is when I've allowed the Word of God to be able to jump off the pages and really the Holy Ghost move inside of my heart to where, as I said many a times and preached it, that the written Word becomes to be a rhema word. It's specific for me. And it's moments like that that when I realize that God is still God and God still cares. And God teaches me that the source of my help ought not to be in a church service. And ought not to be in emotionalism. And I believe that when things get spiritual, I believe you will be emotional. But there is a key factor that a lot of times that we miss. And it's just the fact that God has given us His Word. I mean, do you understand? And we'll unfold it here in a little bit. Do you understand that this is literally the voice and the Word of God? God Himself spoke this. And there's going to be times, and you hear me well when I say this, that you're not going to hear God speak in your life. If you want to know why this is pressed on my heart so much, is because I, like some of you, have been in those seasons where I haven't heard God speak as clear and loud as I wanted God to speak. But one thing for sure, though I might not have understood, and maybe it wasn't relevant at the time, and maybe I didn't even know, because sometimes, as we've preached many times, the seed gets planted, and it gets planted, but you don't ever see the fruit of it for a ways off. Sometimes, just reading the Word of God, you might not believe this, but the Holy Ghost is just planting seeds in my dark season. And it'd be 6 months later or a year later, I look back and, man, I wrote something down. I think, man, that's exactly what God was talking about. And all of a sudden, my hunger, my heart begins to beat again, because what happens is now I'm not running on emotionalism. I'm not running on how exciting things are and how everything's bouncing off the walls and people are shaking hands and joining the church and getting saved. Sometimes the enthusiasm of church can help you run well, but sometimes there's dry seasons, and there's going to be dry moments, and there's going to be times where you are doing everything that you should and you're supposed to do, and listen, praise God that you do. But sometimes routine, even though it's spiritual, is not enough. Read the text, if you will, verse number 16. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 16, "For we have not followed cunningly devised fables when we made known unto you the power and coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, but were eyewitnesses of His majesty. For He received from God the Father honor and glory when there came such a voice to Him from an excellent glory, 'This is My beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased.' And this voice which came from heaven we heard when we were with Him in a holy mount. We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto ye do well that ye take heed, as unto a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn, and the day star arise in your hearts, knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost." If you was to look at a certain verse, I really just skimmed the surface the other day, and it was on my heart. It was three or four Sundays ago when I shared this verse. I'd been pondering verse number 19. And it said in that verse, it said that when you take heed, and it says, as a light that shineth in a dark place until the day dawn and the day star arise in your hearts. I mean, you're talking about a time to where you realize that it seems to be so overwhelming in your life, and it seems to be a dark time, but yet the day star, well, I'll share this again, but the Bible says in Revelation chapter number 22, verse number 16, that the Lord, that He is the morning star. He is the day star. So what He's talking about is in dark moments of your life when you seem to be all alone, when death and cancer and situations have settled in, that there's times that you can have a certainty, a sure word, that when you read the Word of God, that Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost Himself, will rise up in you and help you stand when you felt like you could not stand. Many times I've talked about different illustrations about things to where, you know, so many times you go and you hear about things, but it's different to be able to meet somebody. Most of you that employ people, you might read a resume, but you always want to interview. Why? Because somebody, you can write a lot of things down, but until you see them face to face, you get to see them for who they are. Can I get an amen? You get to learn about them and see some things about them that you just don't see on paper. And just because it's on paper, sometimes by human nature, we might believe it, but we don't believe it. You know what I'm saying? We might see it, but we don't know it. But when somebody stands before you and you see the way they carry themselves and how they're true to the Word and the way that they function and operate and how loyal they may be, sometimes that resume, it comes to life, and by that interview, you get to know exactly who they are. And that's exactly what the Bible ought to be. A time where you sit down and you read the resume of God. This is the literally resume of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Ghost Himself. You can read it, but let me say this. God wants you to have more than just a resume. He wants you to have more than just a piece of paper that talks about Him. He wants you to have more than just some kind of doctrinal statement. He wants you to be able to see Him for who He is and know Him for who He is and come face to face to where you know that's my God. God, not just a God you read about. So here in this text, you see how the Bible talks about it being moved of the Holy Ghost and not of spirit. The Bible says in verses 16 to 18, that Peter is recounting, he's reminding, he is reminiscing, you can look this way, about the Mount of Transfiguration. If any of you know your Bible, it was a time to where literally, Peter, James, and John had went up, and when they went up to the Mount of Transfiguration, Moses and Elijah was there. So here you all of a sudden, you have two men that were literally not took by death in a way that most people was taken by death, but they were Old Testament men that had actually came representing not just the prophetic statement, if you will, when it comes into the Word of God, but also Moses being the law. So you have the Old Testament and two different men being Elijah and Moses. Y'all with me? Say amen. And then all of a sudden you get Peter, James, and John, the epistles, the ones that write it. So the Bible says that when they came to that place, that literally in the midst of that, that you have the Old Testament that meets the New Testament. And what you get is you get the complete Bible right there on the Mount of Transfiguration. You believe that? Say amen. But see, there's a key. Jesus is in the center of them. And the Bible says that when Jesus was seen in the middle of a representation of the Old Testament coming with the New Testament, the Bible says that when Jesus was seen, when He was acknowledged, when He was found, when He was recognized, that the doors of heaven opened up and God spoke out. And He said, "This is my beloved Son in whom I'm well pleased." Here's the point that you need to understand tonight, and this is it. You can read the Bible and have the Old Testament and New Testament all you want down, but until you see Jesus, you're never going to hear from heaven. You've got to get to a place where you get your Bible, and as boring as it makes, and God forbid, and have mercy on your soul if you feel that the Bible is boring. But I'm telling you, when you get to a place where you see the Lord in it, the Bible says that God had opened up and began to speak. Listen, there's been times in my life where I've read this, and you've been just like me, and I've read it in the midnight hour. I've read it in the daytime. I've studied it. I've quoted it, and it's just words. Hey, but then all of a sudden, it seems like I see the Lord in the middle of it. And Jesus talking to me. And it's then that I hear from heaven, when God speaks peace to my soul, well, I got peace that passes all understanding. Not because of just reading a book. Not because of just sitting back and acknowledging what's on the paper. It's not a knowledge. It becomes an experience. And if there's anything that we need tonight, it's an experience with God. I want you to notice a few things. The issue at hand is this, as he talks about how heaven opened up. But the issue at hand is this, as he speaks, he says this, he says in literally that we also have more of a sure word of prophecy. See, Peter was talking, but here's the deal. I'm happy for your testimony. And I'm happy for Peter's testimony. And I'm happy for everybody else's testimony. But let me say this. If you love the Lord and you love the Bible and you're saved by the grace of God, you don't want to piggyback off of nobody else. You don't want to piggyback. I mean, listen, I'm not blaspheming the Word of God or the Lord or anything whatsoever, but the Mount of Transfiguration, praise God for that. But listen, I'm glad that they seen Jesus. Let me say this, in 2017, the month of March, I want to see Jesus today the way they did back then. I want to see Jesus the way they did whenever he went at Mount Carmel. And I want to see Jesus now the way that they see whenever the Lord had moved in and he made the deaf to be able to hear and the blind to be able to see and the lame to be able to walk. I want to see Jesus now. I want my own story. I want my own miracle. I want my own help. I want my own healing. And the Bible says that you too can have a sure word. You can. But you got to learn what to look for in the Bible. The Bible says in verse number 19 that the day star will arise in your hearts, knowing that literally, that just as they saw that day on Mount of Transfiguration, listen to me, Peter is telling us. By the way, here's key to this. I learned this last Friday. Peter is talking to a second generation of Christians. You know why that's so important? Because this is a generation that had not seen Jesus with their eyes. You know what our generation is? We're a generation that has not seen Jesus with our eyes. Are y'all with me? Say amen. The reason that's so important, man, when it stood out to me, I was thinking, oh my goodness, I mean, that's the key to it. Because Peter is saying, listen, I know you haven't seen what I've seen. And I know you haven't experienced what I've experienced. And I know you haven't encountered what I've encountered. But Peter's saying, even though you're another generation, that if you will do these things, you will have a more. King James says more. Everybody say more. More means more. Can I get an amen? You can have a more sure word. In other words, you could be more confident what I was than I seen Jesus with my own two eyes. You can't argue Bible. Somebody say amen. But he said there's a way to do it. But here's the problem. We got a lot of us living in darkness because we're not operating the way the Bible tells us to operate. A couple questions tonight. Number one, so how do I have this experience? How do I have my own personal mountain myself? The Bible says in verse number 19 that there's a more sure word. But he says how? That you take heed as unlight to darkness in the dark, light shineth in the dark place until the day dawn, until the day star rise in your heart. Here's the key. The dark place is the world. How do you have your own experience? How do you actually get to see Jesus in the middle of your mess and the middle of your problem? Here's the deal. You've got to be committed more to the Lord Jesus Christ than you do the world. What is the world? Man's ideas. What is the world's? World, man's opinion. What is the world, what books say and what philosophers say and what people say? Listen to this. If you want to see Jesus today in the middle of everything that you're facing, in your darkest hour, in your brightest hour, and everything else, you got to be more committed to seeking out for godly things than you do worldly things. Right. Are you with me? Say amen. And listen, here's the problem. This is where we're falling. We would rather be tickled on our ears to hear what we want to hear than hear the truth. And that's how the devil's got us deceived. He said, if you will be more committed to the truth, to the light, God's way. God, listen, I know it's not comfortable. Everybody today, they get married, and they don't want to hear the right stuff about being married. They don't want to hear about purity and not shacking up. They don't want to hear about all that. He says, but if you want to see Jesus Christ in the middle of your situation, you got to do it God's way. Amen. 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 He said there's a more sure word. The problem is this. We got a lot of people that's not seeing the light, not seeing the day star, not seeing Jesus, because they're more committed to the darkness. Can I ask you a question tonight? What's so good about what the world says? Let's remove ourselves from the equation, because usually when we're removed from the equation, we'll be a little more honest than what we would if we was in the middle of it. Amen. Look at what this world has done to this world. Look at our children. Look at our homes. Look at our marriages. Look at our schools. Look at our churches. And by the way, a church that's operating off of a mindset and a man's made theology is just as much the world as those that are sitting out there in the bar. Amen. People are dying and going to hell. Churches are closing the door and dwindling because we're so consumed and more committed to the darkness than what we are to light. Second question I'd ask this. How do I know if I'm committed? Well, the Bible says in verse number 19, notice the text, very simple, whereunto you do well that you take heed. You want to know if you're committed or not? It's whether or not you're applying what's being preached every Sunday. It's whether or not when you read about forgiveness and you study that book, and that study is more than just a study in a book for your knowledge, but it becomes an experience.
Right. Amen.
So instead of reading somebody's book, the next sister that comes to you or the next brother that comes to you, you can speak to them about forgiveness because you have applied what the Bible said to you.
Amen.
So how do you know if you're committed? Well, the key is are you applying? Are you taking heed to what the Bible says? How long has God dealt with your heart about a certain subject, and today you're still running from it, and you wonder why you're not in the center of God's will? You wonder why you're struggling. You wonder why you have no peace. You wonder why you're not singing like you used to sing or like you want to sing, or why you're not committed like you used to be committed. Truth be told, because you're not taking heed to the Word of God like you used to. You know, it amazes me when people first get saved, and I dare say all of us was this way. The preacher could get up, and he honestly could preach on TVs, skirts, shorts, earrings, long hair. I mean, whatever. Stuff that ain't even Bible. It's opinion. Not all of it. Some of it. Everybody all right? Am I telling it right, Brother Larry? Okay, good. And it didn't matter what they said. We would throw it out the window real quick just simply because we wanted to do what was right for the Lord Jesus Christ. Y'all remember those things? I do. You ain't got to be honest, but I do. And I remember when stuff would happen, it didn't make no difference. I mean, literally, I use this example a lot, but I remember I used to work at Flo, and I walked by, and I used to always do the Sunday thing, and it would be on Friday, and they'd print out who's going to win the games, and now we'd circle. All we got was a drink out of it we won. But I'll never forget this man looked at me. He said, I thought you said you got saved, boy. I said, I did. Why are you still gambling? I didn't even know nothing about gambling. I didn't. But what I knew is if that's what it took for people to see Jesus in me, I'd give it up. Now, and it's in this church a whole lot. When you talk about somebody what they don't want to give up and they want to justify it, they'll get mad at you for calling them out. Yes, absolutely. Absolutely. And listen, that don't mean that we ought to have a loud mouth and say what we want to say and speak the truth. But that don't mean you also got to tolerate it and accept it either. Hey, you can speak truth, but the Bible says speaking truth in love. Everybody with me? Say amen. Hey, it don't say you can't speak truth. Just when you speak truth, speak it in love. But today, you speak truth in love, people get mad. People get mad. They get upset. The Bible says this in Colossians 3:16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly. You don't know if you're really committed or not. I want to know how much the word of God is actually dwelling in you. Right. How much during the daytime do you ponder the Bible compared to pondering what you do or what's being said or songs to a song or lyrics to a song or ponder what's going on or what you're doing? Or I mean, we ponder everything, but how much is the word of God dwelling in you? Think about it. The Bible says this in James 1:19 to 21. It says being quick to hear and slow to speak. Quick to hear who? God. God's point of view. Slow to speak yours. Amen. Applying what God says about the matter. Y'all with me? Say amen. He says if you really are committed, then there ought to be an operation of the word of God inside of your spirit. Here's a good sign. Are you convicted about the things that God's not pleased with? And if not, then we pull this card. Well, I didn't know the Bible said that. Why not? You've been saved. How long? Some of us have been saved, and I'm not being mean. Some of us have been saved for 5+ years and have yet to read through our Bible. Some of us have been saved 20+ years. And says, I can't quote verses. But I tell you what we can quote. Shania Twain, Hank Williams Jr., you know, all the rap music, Lynyrd Skynyrd, Sweet Home Alabama. We can quote anything, but we can't quote the Bible. Huh? I mean, I touch all of you, you know, rap music, gospel music, rock and roll music, you know, Kenny G. He ain't got no words. But y'all done tried to play the saxophone. Listen, I'm not knocking. What I'm telling you is this. By experience, I have learned by being put down in the resting position where he maketh me to lie down, as I preach Sunday, when he has made me lie down, the green pasture and the still water didn't come from a sermon. And it didn't always come from a good godly friend. And it didn't always come from somebody else. Sometimes it come from my Bible. And I'd sit there and I wouldn't know. And it's like I preach Sunday talking about the little things. I mean, I have. I mean, I can go all through the scripture. And over the last 4 years, it's amazing you never realize something until you're really desperate to see it. Y'all ever get that way? There's been so many scripture that over the last 4 years I have read, seen, heard preached, and preached myself that never had the meaning in my heart like it gained over the last 4 years. Because I learned to get committed because I got broken. And I learned to get dedicated because I love y'all. But everything y'all tell me ain't always true. Right. And everybody tells me they love me don't always love me. Right. And vice versa. Right. But whether I have my church, my family, and I've had a lot of people walk away from me. People that I've leaned on, loved. But God has had to be my sufficiency. Right. And I'm telling you tonight, and I'm almost done, but listen to me. What he's talking about is you've got to be committed to take heed to the word of God. Right. If you want a successful life, you need to do what the Bible says. Let this book of the law not depart out of thy mouth, but meditate on it day and night. Then thou shalt have success. Y'all with me? Say amen. You know, we want so many of the other stuff, but we want this success, we want that. And listen, I know tonight, it ain't just about coming to church. We need success in our marriage, in our home, in our finances, in our joy. I mean, we're struggling every area. We need a message like that. No, you don't need a message like that. You need a word for that. You need a word for that. And even in Haines Baptist Church, me being the pastor, there's been times that I have not neglected, but I've been obedient to the Lord, but I have failed to put such an emphasis the way that I should. I'm not giving you a good principle and not giving you a good outline. But if you notice anymore when I preach, sometimes I ain't even got an outline. It's like tonight. Why? Because you don't need that. You need the Bible. And I know a lot of people don't like that teaching, preaching, but that'd be all right. Let me say this. If it's good preaching, it's good teaching. Yeah, if it ain't preaching. It's hollering. Say it. Camp meeting. Hey, listen. And I'm all about, y'all seen it. I get up here, walk on pews, and have my Sunday too. Camp meeting crowds don't want to talk about that stuff. But God didn't call me to be a camp meeting preacher. He called me to be a pastor. And we got to get the Word of God and let it dwell richly inside of our soul. Miss Deborah, you go ahead and come. Keep your Bible open. I want to give you one more thing. Let me say, I wrote this down. Listen to this. Listen to this. Luke 24. The Bible, don't turn there. The Bible says that them disciples are walking and they're discouraged. And when Jesus comes up, what does he do? He himself quotes the fact of what the prophet said. Y'all remember that? And this is what he said. They spoke about me. Because here's the principle. It shows you that in the New Testament, you need more than just the written word. You need the living word. Amen. Amen. Don't you like how Bible backs up Bible? You got to see Jesus. You got to see Jesus. I wrote this text down. 1 Thessalonians chapter number 2, verse 13 and 14. It said, effectually worketh also in you that believe. In other words, when you act on the word, it's when it performs inside of you. I want to ask you something. When's the last time right now that you could think of a message that caused you, not the message, but the Holy Ghost used it as a channel, a direct line, where it changed your life so much that it did something inside of you that changed you, and you ain't been the same since. Amen. I could tell you when it did happen the day you got saved. Somebody say amen. Okay, now we know what God's done. Let me ask you what you've done. When's the last time that you have read something in your Bible and has changed the way you thought, you acted, you spoke, amen, you functioned, you responded? When's the last time?
Amen. That's good.
You want to know if you're committed? When's the last time?
Amen. Good.
When's the last time? The last thing I want to say to you is this. How does it happen? Verses 20 through 21, knowing this verse, that no prophecy of the scripture is any private interpretation. For the prophecy came not in the old time by the will of man, but holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
The Bible says they were moved. What's that mean? It means like a wind. You know, when you get out on the ocean, you don't have any control about being pushed or any, all you can do is set up your sail. And by doing your sail the certain way, it will determine where you go. But if it was not for the wind, what, nothing ever happened? Y'all with me? Say amen. You're with me? Say amen. That's what it's talking about. The Holy Ghost moved. If it wasn't for the Holy Ghost, them men would have never got what they got, which is now the infallible, inherited, inspired Word of God. Now, I've said this before and I'll say it again, because a lot of people discredit it, and I want you to take this and let somebody put it in their pipe and smoke it when they tell you this. Yeah, but I don't believe that the Bible, there's been men, sinful men that has taken this book and yeah, they wrote it down. There's no way that a dirty vessel like us. Well, there's a lady by the name of Mary. And she too was human, humanity, just like you and I. At best, she was sinful. The Bible says that she conceived Son of God and the Son of Man. Literally, she birthed Jesus Christ. You know why? Because the Holy Ghost covered and kept sin out while it kept humanity in. You believe that? Say amen. Do you know why the Bible is still inspired? Because the Holy Ghost covered. And why them men penned the words of God that speaks to you so much today and the way it speaks to me. He covered and kept out sin while he kept in humanity. The power ain't in the vessel.
Right. Amen.
Amen.
Yes, sir.
It's not in the vessel.
That's right.
So he says there, listen to this. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of Scripture is of any private interpretation. Prophecy came not in old time by the will of man, but holy God, holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost. So the same way that the Holy Ghost moved in them, when you read the Word of God, is the same way that the Holy Ghost can move in you. That's how it works. You and I, look, we still have sinful flesh. Our minds are still wicked. The heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Our heart, our intentions are still wicked. Can I get amen? But there's something pure enough about that word when the Holy Ghost transfers it, explains it, applies it. The very pages that you read become to be a reality. Listen, God wants you to have more than just a knowledge. He wants you to have an experience. You don't just need to know that he's the comforter, that he's the lily of the valley, that he's the bright morning star, that, you know, he's the Alpha and the Omega, and he's Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Nisi, Jehovah Rapha. I mean, we can name all that. I'm glad you know that. But when's the last time you've experienced him that way?
Amen. Amen.
I know 1 John 1:9 is real. If you confess your sins, he's faithful. I know that. But how come we still got unconfessed sin that stays in our life?
Amen.
We all do. Just think of what God can do. I want to close with this. Don't ever belittle or discredit the Bible the way that so many churches and even pulpits have today, and even Christians. I know we're growing. I know God's doing some things in this church. But listen, if we're going to keep growing, we got to keep a strong foundation. And it's got to be Bible. Because I promise you, the devil would love to split this church right down the middle. And trust me, I felt like there's been arrows. Even a preacher was pastor, and I was here, you know. Amen, Miss Diana. You want to run around the church on that? Miss Diana, hey, listen. Bless her heart, man. Y'all need to pray for her. She's been through a lot. Stuff you say, well, you got a bad... No, we ain't got a bad church. But there's a wicked devil trying to stir it up.
That's right.
Keep your foundation. Let it be the Bible. Tonight, maybe you just want to search your heart. God, will you help me open my eyes? Will you give me a hunger for the Word? Will you help me apply it? Father, I love you tonight. Thank you. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the liberty. Thank you, Lord, for the attention. Lord, may we heed to what the Bible teaches. In Jesus' name, amen.
As the pastor, I want to thank you for viewing our video today. However, if God's dealt with your heart, we do not want to end this video without giving you a chance to be able to accept Jesus Christ as a personal Savior. If you're there today and God's actually dealing with your heart, I want to remind you what the Bible says, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That means every single one of us has had problems, issues, sin, failures, faults in our past. The great thing is this, is that Jesus says, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh through the Father but by me. There is a way to be able to have hope, to have eternal security within the Lord Jesus Christ, to be able to know that you're saved by the grace of God. Now the great thing about the Bible is it tells us about the love of God. He says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth him shall not perish but have everlasting life. And that's amazing to a lot of people, and they can quote it. But the beauty of it is this, is the very next verse tells us the purpose of Christ. Because the Bible says, for God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. That means that God sent his Son to die for those of us who are sinners so that we can have fellowship with God Himself. Now, if you're there today and God's really been dealing with your heart, I want to ask you this question. Do you really believe that God's been dealing with you about salvation? If that's the case today, then I want to tell you what you need to do is repent of your sins. You need to die to yourself. Admit that you're lost and you're on your way to hell. And then look at what the Bible tells us, that He tells us that we can be saved through Christ. Who do you call on? There's only one. As the Bible says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. It's only through Christ and Christ alone. So I tell you today, would you trust in Christ? When I ask you, would you trust in Him as a personal Savior? You say, Brother Jason, I don't really know if I can do that. Well, let me tell you, the Bible also tells us that whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It don't matter who you are, where you come from, God sent His Son to die for everyone. If you've made this decision today to be able to trust in Christ, to be able to die to yourself, to be able to start living for Christ and accept Him as a personal Savior after repenting, would you do us a favor and be able to contact us at 336-788-0551 and let us know about this decision that you made so we can start praying for you. Thank you so much.